Emilia Gagacin, and I'm allowed here on the stage on behalf of the Advisory Council on Youth of the Council of Europe. So I guess before I tell you anything else, I should use this opportunity to also just tell you briefly about what this council, Advisory Council on Youth, does. So, Advisory Council is basically a committee of the Council of Europe. We are 30 young people who represent youth organizations in Europe. And some of us come from European youth organizations, such as myself. My organization is European Federation for Intercultural Learning. In many of your countries, you will know this organization is AFS. Some other colleagues of the Advisory Council, they come from national youth councils. Others come from local youth organizations. This way, we kind of strive to represent the heterogeneity of young people in Europe. And what is the goal of this Council on Youth? So our mission, or basically what we do as a committee in the Council of Europe, is to decide on youth sector priorities, program, and goals. We do this through a unique structure of co-management. This means that our committee does not decide alone on things, but we sit together with governmental representatives of Council of Europe member states, and we decide on all things together in a consensual manner. In the Council of Europe, there are many committees where member states sit, and occasionally there are also young people who are allowed to sit in these meetings. But in our council, we really get to decide on things. So it's not only being visible, it is also really co-shaping what's happening in the Council of Europe when it comes to youth. We are very proud of this, and we try to promote it wherever we go. So basically, we try to make the voice of youth heard within the Council of Europe, and we do this by acting and reacting on the situation of young people and youth organizations in Europe. And as I said, we decide on things, and recently we adopted our 10-year strategy, called Youth Strategy 2030. And this was a very long process, because as I said, we decide everything centrally. But we are very happy to bring forward these documents that will be programmatic for the work of the youth department for the next decade. The strategy will be formally launched next year, but I can already tell you what our priorities are for the next 10 years for the youth department, and those will be revitalizing pluralistic democracy, young people's access to rights, living together in peaceful and inclusive societies, and of course, youth work. And our vision is to enable young people to actively uphold, defend, promote, but also enjoy the core values of the Council of Europe, which are, as you know, human rights, democracy, and rule of law. So, who are we? We're 30 young people, just like 30 of those before us, and those before us, and those before us, all the way back to the 70s when this co-management was founded. And this is really important for you to say, we are all offsprings of your work, of European youth work, of local youth work, of national youth work. So you can see where all that can get young people in representing their voice. Now that you know who sent me here, I just wanted to give you a couple of takes of my own on Europe. So Matthew already told you what he thinks about it. I will also begin by saying that Europe, as you all know, came together after the Second World War, dreaming about peace and freedom and democracy. But now thinking of my generation, for most people in my generation, this former utopia has mostly been reality their whole lives. Unfortunately, to an extent that many of us started taking it for granted, and not only on the European level, but also in our own countries. I just told you about a couple of things that indicate in this direction. In other parts of the continent, this utopia has not quite been reality yet. In some regions, like my home region in the Balkans, we are still struggling to practice democracy and freedom. At times, we are enthusiastic about becoming formally European, entering the European Union, but at times, we are also disillusioned at the lack of welcoming and solidarity coming from the states of the European Union. I strongly believe that education for European citizenship needs to teach us about the past, because peace and freedom that we enjoy on this continent, with some unfortunate exceptions, are something that we really cannot take for granted and we need to kind of remember all the time. But at the same time, I believe that education for European citizenship also needs to provide space and resources for young people to come up with new ways of imagining Europe. And if I understood correctly, there will also be a project that is called Imagining Europe that will tell us in concrete how this can look like. I think this is really crucial because it is actually dreams of common future that bring us together constructively, not reinventing the past all the time. and these dreams of a common future need to be grounded in young people's understandings of community, of democracy, of citizenship, that might be different from how you imagine community and democracy and citizenship. And I'm saying this because I really believe that the role of citizens in democracy is changing. In the past 2 decades, we have seen a rise of new and expressive forms of citizenship practices, such as political consumerism and digitally enabled forms of political participation, such as hashtag movements. And often, very often, these are not considered political because many of them do not engage directly with institutions or like institutional politics. And this really strikes me, I have to say, because what is posting and sharing of political content using hashtags for collective action if not struggle for voice, struggle for recognition, and struggle for political attention for certain issues? We have witnessed the power of this connective action on issues like climate change, not only in Europe, but also worldwide, but also action on anti-gun laws in the US with hashtag movement March for Our Lives. It also took to the streets in the end. And I mean, it is not only the public that sees the influence that young people can have in shaping public agenda, but also young people. And this way, young people are really co-shaping the public agenda, but if and only if they manage to mobilize enough attention for issues that are important to them. And very often these are not some small issues. I mean, in case of March for Our Lives, it was young people marching for their right to be, you know, to education, to safe education. And this is something happening in a country that's leader of the free world. So those are not small issues that young people are protesting for and against. So this is to say, young people are not necessarily disenfranchised with politics, they just participate in new ways. Ways that do not always appear to be political. So it could be a task of education for European citizenship to provide young people with political competences and skills to understand the problems affecting them, formulate their interests, and all of this in order to engage in fights for their rights and for recognition, but through forms of political participation that appeal to them. This way, their participation in the public discourse and in politics will not be reduced to visibility, but will actually give them the real sense of political agency. Now, moving back from this non-institutional forms of participating, and coming to institutional participation of young people, Matthew gave you a quote of a US judge that emphasized the importance of the spirit of liberty and democracy, but then also in a qualified way gave his opinion on that. I actually also wanted to quote the Supreme Justice from US, Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Many of you maybe saw the movie about her. I found it very inspiring, especially one quote that I will reformulate for this purpose. She said, "Protests are important, but changing the culture means nothing if structures do not change." And despite having proved on many occasions that young people care about their rights, care about democracy, care about minority rights, social rights, labor rights, we are still begging for the attention of institutions, from local institutions all the way to European institutions. So I think we should just admit that the time has come for a comprehensive introduction of co-management structures and real participation of young people in institutional politics. And I think also education for European citizenship could empower young people to seek their voice being represented in nothing less than all decision-making that affects them. This way, young people could actually be concretely co-shaping societies that they live in, that they want to live in, and also putting these dreams and imaginations of Europe into practice. So, to conclude, if we want young people, and actually people in general, to care about Europe, and here I mean Europe as a place of belonging and not defined by a passport, we really need an idea of Europe beyond this self-sustaining technocracy that sometimes appears to be on one hand, and these dreams of the common past, and not saying that this is not important, but I think that in Europe we need a new utopia that recognizes our history of struggle for peace and freedom, but at the same time formulates future promises that can actually change our lives for the better. We in Advisory Council, we know what youth work can bring about young people, and this is why we also know that we can count on you to enable and empower new generations of young Europeans to advance this unique project of ours. This being said, I thank you for your attention and I wish you a fruitful and interesting forum.